Happy Sunday, beautiful people. I'm so excited that you are here today with us. My name is Tiffany Latrice, and I am the Artistic Director of National Black Arts. So you were hearing me speak over the slideshow. Just wanted to kind of welcome you all into this incredible, amazing experience. We had the honor and pleasure of partnering with Freedom Park Conservancy to produce this virtual experience in honor of the Elder Project, which is a public art installation in Old Fourth Ward at the Freedom Park. And the artist was Masud Olufani. So this year's theme for National Black Arts is Rising Above. And that means ascending together with a focus on collaboration to engage diverse audiences and to elevate our collective conscious. This project is a true exemplary of that mission and that theme. And it's no coincidence that this experience is on the day of John Lewis's birthday. So we're all making good trouble and necessary trouble. So before we get started, I wanted to just go over today's experience agenda. Give me 1 second and I'm gonna pull it up for you all so you know what you're getting yourselves into. And drop in the chat your name, say hi, see if you see your friends. We're gonna have a really, 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 really awesome time today. All right, got it. Then I'm gonna pull in Nancy as well. All right, y'all, so here's the experience. So I gave my opening remarks, just a general housekeeping. Make sure you keep yourselves on mute during this whole entire time. We'll get into a live panel discussion in about 10 after, and then we'll go into a live Q&A. So you will have the opportunity to talk with Dr. Calinda Lee, as well as Masud Olufani, Okorie, as well as the incredible historian, Nasir Muhammad. I would be remiss if I don't introduce you to the incredible, incredible Nancy Boyd, who is the vice chair of Freedom Park Conservancy. Nancy, I'm gonna pull you in. Just give me 1 second. Nancy's gonna be joining us. Nancy? All right. Welcome, Nancy. Thank you so much for being here with us today. You are so incredible. And without your hard work and persistence on this project, we would not be sitting here today bringing this live experience from the comfort of our homes. So Nancy, take it away.
Tiffany, all of those same sentiments. This has been a real pleasure working together. So thank you. Want to take this opportunity to welcome everyone on behalf of National Black Arts Festival, as well as Freedom Park Conservancy. And thank you for joining us today. More than 2 years ago, the Elder Project began in the imagination when a passionate group of civic actions, citizens ignited the artistic imagination. The Old Fourth Ward community members stepped up and they wanted to save the historic trees on the school property of David T. Howard. They recognized the value of the history of those trees. They were witness to this extraordinary history. They nurtured generations of families, and these are the oldest members of our community, the elders. So the community action that sparked the imagination, these ideas took root. And the ideas grew, and concrete action made Elder a vibrant artistic reality. None of this would have happened without a shared vision. So I just want to very quickly note some of the key people that and organizations that were part of this unique process that Masud directed and oversaw. The David T. Howard School Alumni Association. Special thanks to Gloria Williams, Godfrey Finch, and Elizabeth Lacey. The Old Fourth Ward community members, the elders, were a critical part of this creative process. The alumni of David T. Howard, Helene S. Mills Community Center, right across from the school and the sculpture. Dr. Kevin Maxwell, who's the principal at David T. Howard, was an enormous support and guide in this process. Danny Gutley from the Atlanta Public Schools, Parish Construction Group was a big part of this effort. And a heartfelt shout out to Art Colafici and John Rood, Matthew Cherry, Christine Hassel at Lord Ake Sargent, Stevens and Wilkinson, Trees Atlanta, the Neighborhood Associations of Fourth Ward, Alliance and Neighbors, City of Atlanta Parks and Rec, and also the Cultural Affairs. Stephanie Owens and Tiffany Latrice have been extraordinary in this process. So thank you again. Let me introduce our panel. Artist Masud Olufani. He's an extraordinary talent, as you will see. As a visual artist and writer, he brought Elder into being. Cellist poet Okorie Johnson, okay cello. Performing for the first time today, Elder Roots and Tree. Historian Nasir Muhammad is a leading scholar of David T. Howard, and moderator Calinda Lee from the National Center for Human and Civil Rights, whose curiosity, integrity, and extraordinary depth of knowledge has been invaluable in leading this discussion. Our hope the discussion today will take root in your imagination and grow. And with that said, let's begin today's program. Enjoy.
Thank you so much, Nancy. That was so beautiful. And it's true, this experience is a true testament to all the collaboration and tenacity to make this a reality. Excited for this panel discussion, and I'm going to stop your video. And we're going to get rolling. Awesome.
Thank you for being here today to talk to us about David T. Howard and the importance of the school and its history to this community. I'd like for each of you to introduce yourselves and tell us why you were so captivated by this particular story. Nasir, you have been identified far and wide as the expert on the history of David T. Howard and of the David T. Howard School. Tell us a little bit more about the man and about the institution that we're exploring today.
Yes, the historic David T. Howard Middle School was established in 1923 in the Atlanta public school system at a time when there was only one school for African Americans, which was Booker T. Washington, a son of Africa by way of Madagascar and an ex-slave, donated the land to be established for education in this community, which is the old Fourth Ward. The school operated up until the 1970s, and then, of course, due to numbers, it actually closes, and it becomes a museum under the Atlanta public school system. And the last 20, 30 years it actually set, and then those of us in the community fought for it to be reestablished, and now it's opening up for the new generation in 2020.
Masud, what inspired you to share the David T. Howard story at all? And why did you choose to do it the way that you did?
My name is Masud Olufani. I am a multidisciplinary artist based here in Atlanta, Georgia, actor and writer. Well, I really didn't know anything about David T. Howard, to be quite honest, when I was approached by Freedom Park Conservancy to execute this work of art. It was one of those stories that for me was kind of under the surface in terms of my knowledge of the history of significant people in Atlanta. I was very moved by his story, being someone who had been enslaved and then Following the issuing of the Emancipation Proclamation and the ending of the Civil War, he was actually able to acquire some resources based on a business that he was able to start, and then purchase some land. And on that land, he chose, instead of building a huge mansion, he chose rather to build a school that would educate the African-American children of the city of Atlanta, which was quite remarkable to think that somebody that would come out of those circumstances would want to make this kind of investment in the future of the city. So I was inspired by his sense of perseverance, his commitment, his sense of service to the community. And I was just so compelled. It was very easy for me to want to dive into creating a work of art that would kind of showcase that aspect of the man and how that commitment to service also generated, all of these remarkable people who came out of this school.
Oh, Corey, what captured your imagination about this story? What led you to create the beautiful composition that you did? And particularly with reference to Paul Robeson, tell us about that process of creation.
So my name is Okorie Okello Johnson, cellist, and I had the honor of composing score, really a soundtrack for Masud's powerful piece of art that helps to kind of highlight and celebrate the history of the school. But most important, I was attracted to the opportunity to write a song about a piece of wood, about a tree that has lived through the life and the history of the city that I'm so powerfully attracted to. It has seen changes in people, that has seen changes in history, that has seen changes in racism, that has seen changes in demographic. And to use my instrument and to complement the communication of that powerful piece of wood, that tree, that Masud shaped and fashioned, into something that I believe is timeless and hopefully connects communities and connects time periods. So all of that together makes this a really rich project to sink my teeth in as an artist and as a musician. I had an opportunity to spend some time or to at least get some feedback from graduates of the Howard School. And one of the questions I asked them was, what was a song or what were sounds that they associated with their memories here? And I got some great songs, but one stood out. It was Paul Robeson. Paul Robeson is a really important figure, obviously within African-American history, but also as a foundational figure of African-American art here in this country. And what I really appreciated was the fact that there was a song that he wrote called Trees. And in that first verse of that song, or I guess he didn't write it, he performed it. But in the first verse of that song, it says, I shall likely never encounter a poem as beautiful as a tree. I think there's such power and beauty in that line. I think there's such power and beauty in wood. I think there is energy. I think there is spirit. I think there is witness in so many ways to the things that happen around them. And I consider it a real great honor to be able to create a piece of music that starts with this kind of spiritual prayer that kind of recognizes the sacred things that have happened and the really important people who have passed through the school, to connect it to that song, Trees, which is embedded in the piece that I wrote. And then to connect that into something that has a contemporary feel to it, a groove. It has kind of a jazz, maybe even R&B feel to it. And for me, that was an exercise in connecting people, connecting histories, connecting communities, and connecting ideas. So that's what I tried to communicate with the piece that I wrote. And that's what I think the piece that Masud has created, that's what I think it effortlessly does.
Nasir, what stoked your curiosity and inspired you about this story? I remember you sharing that you didn't initially think that you were going to undertake research about this man at all, and you stumbled upon him and couldn't stop digging. Tell us why.
The story actually starts with an African-American woman who has an orphanage in Covington, Georgia. Her name is Dinah Watts Pace. Her brother is one of the founders of Southview Cemetery, which is where prominent African-Americans such as Reverend A.D. Williams, Daddy King, and others are buried. And when I went through her history and some of the deeds and records of the financial supporters, this one man, David T. Howard, name continued to come up. So I was curious as to how an African-American man at that time was giving money to an institution that was not in Atlanta, east of Atlanta, and why. Come to find out, his daughter marries Frederick Douglass' grandson, who was the first African-American to be recorded as a violinist in American history. And their son ends up marrying Booker T. Washington's granddaughter. And so I was extremely connected with David T. Howard at that point.
Masud, what stoked your curiosity about this particular story? Tell us a little bit about your process in coming to develop the art piece that you did.
One of the key elements of the work, which I was told was going to be something that had to be integrated into the process, was the use of this old growth elm tree that was part of a cluster of trees that kind of circumambulated the entire school, the grounds of the school. So I was able to use that and have that as be like kind of the anchoring, the conceptual anchoring of the work, as the tree is kind of like an elder. I mean, it's an old growth elm tree that's probably some 125 years old. So it's seen a lot. It's been a witness to a lot of the history in the city of Atlanta. And so in a very real sense, it's an elder. And then to incorporate also the hands of the elders, the people elders who were educated in this building, to have those two iterations of memory and meaning was a very powerful concept that I wanted to engage around. So, yeah.
Nasir, you told me that this school opened in the 1920s and closed in 1976. And that when it closed, people in the community were pretty concerned, and many people, particularly alumni, were sad to see the school close. What do you think they feel now that it's reopened? And what do you think that reopening has to offer to this community?
The Alumni Association, myself, and many of those, of course, have passed on, but we were actively engaged in trying to make sure that the building came back up. It was asbestos, it was not being used, and there was records. I found records in the Atlanta Public School System from meetings where they were planning to demolish the building. And we flooded the Atlanta Public School System meetings every opportunity we could, ended up being where you have a $50 million plus operation that's back in the Atlanta Public School System. And it's historic because it's the same school that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. graduated from.
Okorie, this year's theme for the National Black Arts Festival is Rising Above. How does that relate to the piece that you created and other insights and feelings you might have about David T. Howard and the David T. Howard School?
And I think what I am excited about with this piece, both Masud's piece and I hope the piece of music that I've written to complement it, is that it's helping us collectively as a community to rise above the kind of amnesia that comes along with progress. That there's a very rich and sacred history in this building and in this space. And that piece of public art in Freedom Park requires that we walk past and that we engage that history. And I hope that I've created a piece of music that helps to support that capture of attention and celebration of history.
Nasir, this year's National Black Arts Festival theme is Rising Above. How do you think that relates to the narrative of David T. Howard and the history of the school?
It fits into David T. Howard's vision in the sense that education, economics, politics, and religion. And as we see in the climate in America, especially Atlanta, the South, right now, it's an upward movement, whether it's economic, whether it's political, whether it's social, and whether it's religious. This is still the Bible Belt. This Atlanta is still the beacon mecca of the South. Considering the fact that we do have some challenges, it still is a beacon of hope in the South, and it's the most prominent city to the South. So we still have that rise up spirit, whether it's in sports, athletics, economics, business, and education.
Masud, this year's National Black Arts Festival theme is Rising Above. How does that relate to the piece that you created?
Well, Rising Above is such a wonderful, I think, kind of way of looking at this work of art, because you know, as you approach the work and you see this old growth elm tree turned on its side, which is one of the original trees that dotted the landscape around the school. So it has seen a lot. It's been around for more than a century. And, you know, and it has this, in some sense, in a metaphorical way, it's this repository of memory and history. And then the hands that kind of grow out of it, which have been, you know, tethered onto the tree itself, are rising, reaching back across the street towards the school, indeed towards the Helene S. Mills, elderly care facility, which is across the street as well, and also reaching beyond towards the heavens. So there's this implied motion of reaching up, reaching out, reaching towards the future, and also to the past. So there's, in a way, this kind of collapsing of time, this linking of what has been to what is now, and possibly the possibility of what can be. And hopefully, in that sense, the sculpture in the end serves as a touchstone of inspiration, where we can recognize that essentially who we are now is because of who we were. And with a deeper understanding of that, we can chart a more progressive, more upwardly mobile course for ourselves in the future.
Nasir, we've spent a lot of time talking about the past today. And I am certainly a proponent of the value of looking back as an historian. But I'd like to ask you, what is the relevance of this history for the issues and concerns that we face today?
I think Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois said it the best. When there is a lack of culture and a lack of appreciation for the arts, there is a downward in terms of the community, in terms of the growth. It's not incumbent upon us to just sit and watch. It's incumbent upon us to get involved. And by all of us getting involved, whether it's artistic, whether it's creative, whether it's whatever form of expression that we have to continue to embrace that, because the new generation is here and they are demanding that.
Thank you for your generosity in sharing your expertise and your passion for this project with us. Now we're going to turn our attention to a lively discussion so that we can learn more about David T. Howard and the school and where we go from here.
Wow, wow, wow. Woo! I get so emotional thinking about this piece because I think the way I came into this role is standing on the shoulders of so many people that paved the way for me to stand in this position. So super excited for this incredible, lively discussion. Hi, Dr. Calinda Lee. Yes, Masud is with us. Let me get Okorie in the building. Who else? We need Nasir to join us. Awesome. Nasir, are you joining us? Yes, it was powerful, Didi. I agree completely. We're about to get into a live Q&A. I'm going to get Nasir on here as well. And everyone, I will be manning the chat, so feel free to drop in any questions. Calinda's going to kick us off with a few questions to start the discussion, but feel free to ask away. We have about 15 minutes for this part, and I'm going to drop off and be manning the chat. But welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us. And I'm turning it over to Calinda. Oh, let me unmute you. Is everybody unmuted? Let me unmute you too, Masud. All right.
Ah, there we go.
There you go.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. I have to say that just like the other attendees, this is the first time I've gotten to see the video the entire way through. And I'm just so excited to see how you've pulled that together. And so I want to offer a word of thanks before I even ask this question to Tiffany and the National Black Arts Festival and the Freedom Park Conservancy as well, because this was quite a challenge to figure out how to do all of this safely and responsibly in this moment of the COVID pandemic and all that good stuff. And so, or not so good stuff, but they were wonderful and imaginative and creative about pulling it together. And so, so thank you for that. So, you know, when we, as it was ending, I'd asked a question about the contemporary relevance of this history. And so the question that I want to pose now is really for all of you, each of you, in turn. as an historian, I think a lot about how the past is important for its own sake, right? Knowledge is important and it builds power. But it also enables us to learn how we might address contemporary issues, how we might address issues of contemporary concern, things like educational equity, things like the relevance of the arts to community building. And I think that in the comments that each of you all made and the artistic work that you shared, it's not just looking past, it's also about being in this present moment and looking forward. And so I'd like for each of you in your own way to speak to that. Why does this past really still matter for us? And what do you think that your work is saying about that?
I think I'll let Brother Nasir, since this is his field, to lead us out of the gates. So go right ahead, Brother Nasir.
Well, I would say that, unfortunately, there's an African proverb that says, until the lion or lioness has his or her historian or storyteller, the hunter always has the best part of the story. And I think that that part of it gives us an opportunity to not only delve into the history, but to be able to be the ones who forge the new generation, those who are coming with us and those who are coming behind us, to basically hear and see it from our perspective, those who are descendants of those who sacrificed so much for this institution, those who are connected to the people who were part of the movement to make it happen, at the same time embracing a community that got involved. So I think that when we share these particular stories with young people, we always have to make sure that there is a starting point. You know, it's one thing to hear a song and hear somebody sample a great artist, like whether it's someone like, let me pick one on my, if someone right now, they were to sample Michael Jackson. Well, if a child hears that sample song and they don't know who the creative genius who produced that, the only thing they're stuck with is the song today. And I think that we have to make those connections, because just as music, just as the arts is ever evolving, there is a genesis. And, you know, our people happen to be that genesis, especially when it comes to this particular project.
Brother Okorie, I'd love to hear what Okorie has to say first.
You know, I didn't enter the project as obviously the historian, and the piece of art was created by the time I entered the project, right? So in some ways I had I might've been one of the first audience members, right? I might've been one of the first people to kind of not only have a reaction to the piece, but I was perhaps one of the only people invited to formally respond. And I think that response is important for me because it reminds me of the fact that I'm walking on hallowed ground in the city here in Atlanta. And there's so many powerful spaces that as I mentioned earlier, that through the kind of amnesia of progress and being busy, we just forget. And I think there is value to knowing history, but I think there is, there's a very real benefit to being able to tap into the sacred parts of the world where you live, to kind of connect to that energy and to create your own relevance to that history and to that presence and to that present. I think there are just far too many moments, far too many spaces in the city that are really important to the present and to the future that we live, that are not remembered, that are not memorialized in any way, shape, or form. And all too frequently, I think we have monuments for quote unquote the great men and women. But we all know that this movement, particularly the civil rights movement, this transcendence out of, well, not that we're completely out of racism and slavery, but all of the effort that we've made to create a city where we can thrive didn't just happen because of great people. It happened because of communities and individuals and families and children. And there's something about the elders piece, I think, that speaks to that communal nature of that progress and that transcendence. Not to say that we don't need our statues and our memorials for great people, we do. But they needed movements, they needed people, they needed communities. And the David T. Howard story and the school legacy really celebrates that community in a way that I found inspiring as an artist.
And I mean, both Nasir and Okorie touched on some really powerful points. I think for me, there's something that about healing that takes place as a community when we're able to really delve into our history in a very truthful and authentic way, and to look at not only the parts that inspire and, you know, compel us with their sense of heroism and sense of kind of making great strides forward, but also the things that are difficult to look at, the things that are challenging. And unfortunately, in far too many instances, our country has done a very poor job of looking into the complexity of our past. And I think something like elder is a way, is a really profound statement. It's what's really amazing about this, we are centering an African-American man who was formerly enslaved, who made this contribution to the community, who comes out of slavery, acquires some substance, some material substance, and then expends that substance on the welfare of the children who are not being educated in the city of Atlanta, right? And then you have a cohort of Black and white and other people who are working together to bring this story to the fore. And that says something very profound about the collective and people coming together, seeing the value in these narratives that aren't just white centered, but are also Black, brown, red, and yellow centered. Because ultimately, if we are one human family, and I firmly believe that fundamentally, we have to be invested in the entire story and not just a narrative that tells part of the story. And so my hope is that this work of art can serve as a catalyst, a kind of touchstone of inspiration for the community at large, that perhaps will compel us as a society to look into these spaces that we have not deemed as sacred by, you know, doing a work of art or in some way creating something visible that speaks to the history that is in that space. And for me, there is also, to be quite honest with you, there's something redemptive about my work in this process, because I was really inspired by what took place at Five Points Martyr Station and the slave market that used to exist on Five Points Martyr Station, on the grounds that are at Five Points Martyr Station. And the fact that the city has not done anything about that history. And yet you have 95 to 97% of the people that move through Martyr are people of African descent. But that history is not just for Black folks, it's for all of us collectively. And the more that we embrace the complexity of who we have been, we find that a profound healing takes place and we're able to move forward unified and create a better future for ourselves collectively.
Way to kick us off, Calinda. That was a powerful question, as you always, always ask great questions. So we have a question from Myrna Clayton from East Point. She says, this is wonderful, great work. And this is for you, Nasir. What was that quote from Dr. King about the arts that you gave? And if you can elaborate a little bit more on that quote, or I think it was, well, I'll let you go ahead and speak, Nasir.
Yeah, the quote was from Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois. He said that when he was frustrated with the lack of appreciation for the arts, there was a strong push, and I'll get the complete quote from him, but there was a strong push during the time when he was at the Atlanta University, and there was a strong push for sports, athletic, the strong Black male athlete. And there was a lack of appreciation for culture and refinement. And so he was frustrated, and he makes mention of the aspect of the arts. I'll pull that quote up for Myrna before we conclude and read it in its entirety.
That would be awesome. And the next question comes from C. Stalker. Sorry, I don't have your first name, but it's probably for Okorie as well as Masud. How do you ensure that art you produce, that you just produce, will stand the test of time?
Well, Okorie, you want to tackle that first, man?
Oh, wow. Well, I'm not sure that I know how to make sure that the art stands the test of time. I think my task was to make sure that I created something that was relevant to this time. And if there is some synergy, if there is some congruence between the piece that I've created and this moment, and the way that this particular piece not only acknowledges and celebrates the past, but also points towards the future, I think I'm in line with the appropriate, I think the entire piece is aligned appropriately for the future and for time. And I just wanted to appropriately fit into that process. In all honesty, you all haven't even heard my piece, so I'm hoping that it works out the way that I suggested it will. But the reality is that my job was to complement a very powerful, and I'm wondering, you know, it's important to say this because we're looking at a screen. It's a very big piece, right? It's a physical piece. It takes up space. And my job was to kind of walk into that space and to feel what I was feeling. If my work does that well, then I think I've succeeded. I hope in 30 or 40 years or 300 years, people will be able to look back at this particular piece and to see that the song resonated with the energy of the artwork. And if that happens, then I think it stands the test of time.
Yeah, I never really really create anything or conceive of anything in terms of having an awareness of an assurance that it will stand the test of time. I think for me, it really is about tapping into something that is spiritually resonant, and then creating something that has an authenticity, a truth about it, that hopefully, if I do my part and get out of the way and allow that process to function the way it should be, functioning, where I'm, you know, primarily a vehicle, that it's imbued with a kind of energy that at its source is spiritual in nature, that resonates for everybody, that everybody can find themselves within the work that's transcendent. The narrative may be an African-American, an African diasporic narrative that may be centered, but humanity is universal and we can find our humanity in everybody's story. So that for me is what I try to do. And hopefully, you know, that is, some of that has been achieved in this piece. At least that's my hope, it's my prayer, so.
Awesome. Well, we're coming up about 2 minutes left of this live Q&A. That went fast. But before we conclude, and Nasir, I'm gonna have you share that quote, but I also wanted to acknowledge Dean's question was, when and why did the mother tree fall? So Nancy did respond that through a live answer. And I'm just going to read her response just in case anyone was curious. So that tree was a 100-year-old American elm tree. A metal pole and fencing was incorporated into the growth of that tree. As a result, it could not be cut down, but it was at a critical location that required it to be removed during the construction phase of the David T. Howard School renovation. In the end, the fencing and the pole became important remnants, adding an artistic value to the tree, but also played a role in preserving it as we sorted out the trees available to us for this artistic expression. Thank you, Nancy, for that thoughtful response. And then Nasir, as you always do, close us out of this Q&A.
this has been a great undertaking, and I don't know, did I leave? What happened?
No, you're still here.
You're here.
I saw something happen on the screen here. I'm like, hold up, wait a minute. Can you still see me, Nancy? What I was going to say, this was a great undertaking. We're talking about someone who was born in 1849 and dies in 1935. And to know that the legacy, to know that even that Alumni Association, and I don't think they get enough credit for being a strong group of elders who stay committed to see that this institution became open. Regardless of the circumstance, regardless of the situation, they stayed in the fight. And it's an honor and privilege to be beside, you know, those elders and to work with them. And then to see the project come in fruition, as I saw many of the alumni share tears over that. I mean, it's great. And it leads me to the quote by W.E.B. Du Bois. And I think it's a quote, some will agree, some will not agree, but it's Dr. W.E.B. Du Bois. Nevertheless, he says, all art is propaganda and ever must be. Despite the wailings of the purists, I stand in utter shamelessness and say that whatever art I have for writing has been used always for propaganda, for gaining the right of Black folk to love and enjoy. I don't care a damn for any art that is not used for propaganda. And I close.
Wow, Nasir, always dropping gems. So I know everyone's been so excited about to listen to Okorie's incredible original composition, Elder Root and Tree. I just also want to take the time to thank Calinda, Masud, Okorie, and Nasir for joining us for a live Q&A on this Sunday. It was so remarkable to have you guys share your passion and your vision for this incredible project. So you guys can drop off, and we're about to continue on with this incredible program. Thank you so, so much. Guys, this is really special for me because a lot of them haven't seen a lot of what we're sharing with you all today. So our panelists are also getting this first view of this incredible work that we were able to produce and curate. So they're getting a treat as well. So here we go. And then I'm gonna take myself off video.
Thank you.
Wow, that was so powerful. That piece is actually, I think, 12 minutes long, as I think Okorie shared, but we couldn't do the whole thing, but we hope you really got the emotion and the sentiment behind his original composition, which really complements his incredible, incredible piece. We're about 10 minutes before we conclude this incredible experience, but I would love for Robert Henderson, who is gonna close us out with a unity prayer. And then I'll close this out before we end. But hi, Robert, how are you? Let me put you off mute.
I'm doing well, and I'm incredibly grateful and for this powerful presentation. Okorie's music was an incredible compliment
to
Masud's masterful piece.
Right? It's just incredible. Like, it makes me cry. I think I've watched it probably about 3 times and cried each time. So today I was able to hold it together. But thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. I'm going to drop off camera, but this is your show, Robert. I know it's going to be powerful and I know it's going to be incredible. So thank you for your time, your energy that you're bringing to close us out with a unity prayer.
Well, everyone, this is a prayer taken from the sacred writings of the Baha'i faith. And it shares the aspiration that was expressed by everyone, by each of the panelists, by the beautiful memorial art that Masud has created, by Okorie's wonderful, masterful piece, that the spirit of unity would galvanize us and recreate from the ashes of our history, a sense of vitality and the ability to go forward for the prosperity of all people. O thou compassionate Lord, thou who art generous and able, we are servants of thine, sheltered beneath thy providence. Cast thy glance of favor upon us. Give light to our eyes, hearing to our ears, and understanding and love to our hearts. Render our souls joyous and happy through thy glad tidings. O Lord, point out to us the pathway of thy kingdom and resuscitate all of us through the breaths of the Holy Spirit. Bestow upon us life everlasting and confer upon us never-ending honor. Unify mankind and illumine the world of humanity. May we all follow thy pathway, long for thy good pleasure, and seek the mysteries of thy kingdom. O God, unite us and connect our hearts with thy indissoluble bond. Verily, thou art the giver, thou art the kind one, and thou art the almighty.
Thank you, Robert, for that beautiful prayer. Thank you so much. I really, really appreciate it. I think what a great way to conclude this incredible experience. I'm gonna have you drop off video and maybe have you stick around. Everyone, I've been reading your chats and your questions, and you want to hear Okorie's full piece. If you want to stick around after the experience, we're happy to host an extra time to actually share with you the full composition that Okorie did. I'm also asked the panelists to stick around just in case some people had any additional questions. Another question was this program going to be available after for additional viewing and to share with your network. Absolutely. We are streaming live now on Facebook, but we'll also be publishing to YouTube and sharing this video with all attendees that attended today. So before I conclude this experience, for those who have a hard stop at 3 o'clock, I would be remiss if I did not end with the Honorable John Lewis and a very famous quote that we all know. Never ever be afraid to make some noise and get into good trouble, necessary trouble. Art has the capacity to change and bring about social movements and justice. It nourishes our mind, body, and spirit. NBAF AF would not be here without your incredible support. So we ask that you continue to follow us on Instagram at NBAF to learn more about our programming, to subscribe to our newsletter, to hear what else collaborations that we're doing this year. And that's at NBAF.org. Again, my name is Tiffany Latrice. I'm the Artistic Director for National Black Arts. I am joined by the incredible Freedom Park Conservancy that brought to you today, Sowing the Imagination. May these seeds have been planted so you can bloom and blossom this year. Thank you all so much and enjoy your Sunday. Thanks again. Bye, everyone. If you want to stick around, I'm going to bring in Okorie back to continue to share about his piece. Thanks again, guys. Okorie, you're a hit. Oh, let me unmute you. Awesome.
Yay.
You are a hit, Okorie. Yes, everyone was a hit. This was so incredible. I'm still so deeply moved by this. I can't believe it's over. But I'm going to like let you take control. This is your show and make you the host while people are kind of coming in and out. If anyone wants to talk to you about your composition, if the panelists also want to stick around as well. But let me make you a host now. Boop, boop, boop. How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. I'm feeling good.
We did it.
Wait, is it just, I mean, Nasir, are you joining us?
Okay, let me, I could add to it. If they want to come in, they could come in.
Boring show here. We need some other folks on the, yay.
Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. So go ahead.
I hear what I know so far. I do know that we're working on making sure that there will be a QR code at the actual site of the tree where you can hear the piece as you're looking at the actual tree. I know that this program will be on your site, right, Tiffany?
And, yes.
But I think the video only extends to that portion of the song for the most part.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I think if we stay tuned, obviously I have the song. I can put it up on my website if that is something.
Maybe that works. Yeah, I think that works.
Maybe make it available to Freedom Park and
there we go.
Festival to kind of fully uploaded.
Yeah, we can embed it in our website. Yeah, so then that people can listen that way.
That'll be good. Yeah. So it'll be completely available. Maybe by
Wednesday of next week.
Wednesday or so.
Yeah. Awesome. That'd be great. So yeah, guys, look out for that. In the interim, if you have any more questions, I think we're about to wrap it up. It's 2 minutes left. Just thank you all so much for sharing your Sunday with us. This has been such a fun experience and project to work on. So inspiring. Yes, inspiring on all levels. Yes, I agree. I'm inspired and excited to continue to do this incredible work.